Om Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam Om Mauna Vyakhya Prakatita Parabrahma Tattvam Yuvanam Varshishthante Vasadrishiganairavutam Brahmanishthaihi Achariendram Karakalita Chinmudram Anandarupam Swatma Ramam Muditavadanam Dakshinamurthy Mide Vatavitapi Samipe Bhumi Bhage Nishannam Sakala Muni Jananam Jnana Dataram Arat Tribhuvana Guru Misham Dakshinamurthy Devam Janana Marana Dukkha Cheda Dakshinamami Chitram Vatataror Mule Vridha Shishya Gurur Yuva Gurostu Maunam Vyakhyanam Shishyastu Chinna Samshayaha Nidhaye Sarva Vidyanam Bhishaje Bhavaroginam Gurave Sarva Lokanam Dakshinamurthaye Namaha Om Namah Pranavarthaya Shuddha Jnaneika Murthaye Nirmalaya Prashantaya Dakshinamurthaye Namaha Chidghanaya Maheshaya Vatamula Nivasine Satchidananda Rupaya Dakshinamurthaye Namaha Ishwaro Guru Ratmeti Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyomavat Vyapta Dehaya Dakshinamurthaye Namaha Bijasyantari Vankuro Jagadidam Prang Nirvikalpam Punaha Maya Kalpita Desha Kala Kalana Vaichitriya Chitri Kritam Maya Viva Vijrumbhayatyapi Maha Yogi Vayasvechaya Tasmai Shri Guru Murtaye Namaidam Shri Dakshinamurthaye. So the first verse, we saw that this entire universe, Vishwam, is like a reflection in the mirror. And also it is like what we see in a dream. Okay. It is as though external to ourselves. But in reality, the entire universe is not external to us. Both the subject and object, the subjective world and the objective world, everything is part of one reality, which is myself. It is all in me only. That is what was explained. But still, there are so many theories about this creation, correct? Different people are talking about the cause of the world. So there are different theories about the creation and whether there is a cause for the creation and whether the universe itself is a creation or not. Okay. All these different theories are there. So, the important thing for us is to understand that Ishvara is the cause of this Jagat. Even assuming that Ishvara is the cause, what is the nature of this cause? What is the nature of Ishvara? How do we look upon Ishvara as the cause of this world? All those things we have to address. Now what Shankara is saying in this Stotra is that how does a sapling, okay, comes out of a seed, okay? We have a seed, we put it in water, it will start germination, correct? It will germinate and a small tiny plant will come out. Now, where was this plant hiding before this? it was avyakta, it was unmanifest, it was in a potential form in the seed. Then when the right conditions are there, proper conditions for it to germinate, it comes out, correct? And then again another seed may come out of that. We can look at it, without stretching the analogy too much, we can look at it as again we have this potential form of the plant, and then once this plant dies, then still the plant is surviving potentially in the other seed and all that. Okay, so it will continue, it is a cycle. So here also we are talking about a cycle. The world manifests from a reality in which it was there potentially. Then during pralaya, okay, everything resolves back into an unmanifest state. So this is what we call creation really. Okay, it was there potentially, then it became manifest and it is available for cognition. Again it becomes unmanifest, it is not available for cognition, but it is there potentially. Okay, so this is what we are talking about as creation. And this entire jagat, okay, jagat idam. So jagat is like the ankura, okay. But before its creation, it was there nirvikalpam, without any differentiation, okay. Undifferentiated form it was there, avyakta, unmanifest, undifferentiated. Like even how the sapling was there in the seed in an undifferentiated form. Then it comes out and it is differentiated, it is manifest, it is available for cognition. Similarly, it is coming out. But even here there may be one doubt. See, the seed is real, from which whatever plant is coming is at least real in terms of this transactional world, correct? Vyavaharika satyam is there. So both the seed and the plant which is coming out of the seed, they are real. Then you also say advaitam, brahma and all that, brahman is limitless. If you have another reality like this avyakta, then what will happen to your advaita? So that is why immediately Shankara has to say, what both the unmanifest potential form and the manifest form, okay, which is available for cognition, they are all only appearances, they are all mithya, okay, they are not a parallel reality to Brahman. They appear in Brahman, and since Brahman is the ashraya, Brahman is where it appears. Like even the snake appears on the rope. So we have to say that rope is the cause of the snake, because rope's existence only is available to the snake, correct? For the person who is only seeing the snake, there is no rope. That person sees only the snake. Now, to him who is an ajnani, we have to say, hey, the snake is not real, only the rope is appearing as snake, correct? That is one standpoint, the teaching we have to say, because we have to account for the appearance of the snake, we have to talk about the rope, and then we have to say, rope only is appearing as snake. Then later on when we talk about the nature of the rope, in the nature of the rope there is no snake, correct? In your understanding of rope there is no snake or snakeness. So we have to say there is no real snake at all. In fact, the snake never appeared, there was no snake on the rope. What is there is really only rope. So once you understand the rope, we don't have to even talk about the snake, or we have to negate the snake, in fact. So this is what is called adhyaropa apavada. So first we have to do adhyaropa, because you are cognizing the world, you are cognizing yourself as an individual in the world, you are actually cognizing a subjective and objective world, you are cognizing a subject-object division, we have to account for that. So we say, yes, this world is there, and this world is nothing but Brahman. Brahman only is appearing as this world. Brahman is the cause of this world. We have to say that. Then we later on we have to say there is no world at all. It's only an appearance. It's not another reality. It was never there, in fact. Okay, that is why it is Maya. It is like a magician's sleight of hand, or whatever. Magicians can even hypnotize an entire audience and make them see something, correct, which was not there in reality. So it is all only Maya Kalpita. So this Brahman as this Maya Shakti, okay, and using that Shakti only it is able to make this appearance appear. And everybody, the individuals are all deluded by the appearance. So we have avidya, we have ignorance. The same Shakti, the Maya Shakti in the hands of the Maya Vi, the magician. The magician is not deluded, understand. In the hands of the magician, it is a power, it is a Shakti. But for those who are seeing, for them the same Maya is ignorance. It's a veil, it is covering the reality. They don't see the reality. They only see whatever is projected, the appearance. So Ishvara is like a Mayavi, he says later, correct? Mayavi Iva Vijrumbhayati. So like the Mayavi, this world is projected by Ishvara using his own Maya Shakti. So for Ishvara, the Maya Shakti does not veil or does not cover anything. Ishvara is Sarvajnaha, in that Ishvara has all knowledge, means Ishvara has self-knowledge, Ishvara knows the reality of himself, herself, whatever. Ishvara you can look upon as male, female, it's up to you how you look upon Ishvara. In fact, we'll even come to that. So if we look upon it as a nimitta karana, we can look upon Ishvara as a male. If you look upon Ishvara as upadana karana, you can look upon Ishvara as female. Or you can look upon Ardhanarishvara also, because for us, Abhinna Nimitta Upadana Karanam. Ishvara is both the intelligent cause and the material cause. But all other theologies, okay, or other darshanas within our Bharatiya tradition, in Indian tradition, also talk about causes, different types of causes, and most of them only accept Ishvara as an intelligent cause. They say that material is different. Ishvara is using some other material to produce this world. Like this, they have their own theories. Now, all those things we have to negate. So here, by showing that Ishvara is not going anywhere else to get any material, is all only Maya Shakti. Through his Maya Shakti is making all these things appear. That means Ishvara is both the intelligent and the material cause. Ishvara does not require some other material to create this world. Okay, that is shown here. So like a Mayavi, or also like a Mahayogi. So here Mahayogi means we can even look upon Vishwamitra's story from the Purana, correct? So there was a king called Trishanku. So many of you may have heard about Trishanku's story, correct? So Vishwamitra promises Trishanku in his own whatever, because Vishwamitra thinks that he is a great tapasvi. He has lot of power. So when Trishanku wants to go to Swarga, he promises that Trishanku will be there in Swarga in the same body in which he is there in the earth. Okay, this story you can independently read also. But, and he, through his tapo bala, whatever he has, correct? His strength, his power from all the austerities he has done, yogic power. He sends Trishanku also to Swarga, to heaven. But then from there, they push him out. They don't allow him to enter heaven. Then Trishanku comes back. Then Vishwamitra becomes very angry. Then he creates a parallel Swarga out of his own Tapobala and puts Trishanku there. So that is called Trishanku's Swarga, correct? Like that, he created an entire world. He is a yogi and he did not go borrowing anything. And he put Trishanku there like this. There is a Purana story is there. Out of his own volition, correct? Yes, Svechaya also. Out of his own desire, volition. So even for Ishvara, in the Upanishad itself, he says, So kamayata bahusyam prajayeti satapo tapyata satapas taptva idagum sarva masrujata. So like this, this is there in Taittiri Upanishad. Even in Mundaka Upanishad also, it says, Yasya jnanamayam tapaha, like that. So, also Mundaka Upanishad also says, Yatornanabhi srijate grinnate cha, like even the spider which creates the web, the yarn, and then again it can roll it back and take it inside itself. If it feels threatened, it will come back in the yarn and it can roll it back within its mouth and take it back inside. That is also shown for Abhinna Nimitta Upadhanam. And also, Ishvara is doing it out of his own desire. And see, all desires and ability to do also. The Ichcha Shakti, Kriya Shakti, Jnana Shakti, everything is Ishvara's. Whatever is appearing in the Jiva in a limited manner is there in an unlimited way, Ishvara already. That is only even manifest within the individual also. That is how we look upon. So, Ishvara desired, and Ishvara need not make any big effort or anything for that. Yeah, because he is only projecting it out of his own Maya Shakti. It is all effortless. So, using his Maya Shakti, Ishvara is projecting the space-time. Desha Kala. Okay, Desha Kala Kalana. Means it is a Desha and Kala space-time together. Okay. And in that what? Vaichitriya Chitri Kritam. So within the space-time world, there is variegated world is there. Correct? Vichitram means what? Variety. Different varieties of things are there. As though many, many, many things are there. We cannot count everything which is there in the creation. Correct? Universe is huge. So many different objects are there. Different things are there. So how can there be even one cause for all these things also can be one question. Correct? Too many things are there. Too many variations are there. Varieties are there. And it is all wonderful, correct? It is a wonder. Just if you look at the creation itself, it is a wonder. Even any scientist, physicist and all should be in wonder, because although everything they are reducing it to a few subatomic particles and all that, or atomic level also, how did this variegated world come then? From a few particles at the atomic level. That is still a thing, wonderful thing, right? It is a matter for wonder. So it's a wonderful and very variety, a world filled with wonder and variety. This entire thing, it is all Maya Kalpita. It is all from Ishvara's Maya Shakti, all this appearance, like even a great magician makes appear so many things. They can bring an entire elephant in front of you and make it vanish also. Or like a great yogi like Vishwamitra, who created an entire Trishanku Swarga for Trishanku Maharaja. So this is possible. It's only an appearance. So there is only one cause, which is Brahman. And when we look upon Brahman as the cause of this entire world, Brahman is Ishvara, who is Abhinna Nimitta Upadana Karanam, who is the same Ishvara is intelligent cause, and the same Ishvara is material cause. There is no difference. Okay? That is shown here very clearly. So this, that means we, in the process, we are negating all other theories, cause and effect theories. Also for us, one important thing here is the cause and effect, both of them always exist. The effect exists in a potential form, even if you don't cognize it, and then it becomes manifest. In a manifest form, you are able to cognize it. So that is our theory of causation. Cause and effect, all of them are always there. But cause can appear in the form of different effects. So when the cause is appearing in the form of one effect, it actually covers the other effect, becomes unmanifest. Okay, that is how we look upon it. And when the some other, so the creation itself is nothing but making one form of the cause appear as an effect, and in the process some other form becomes unmanifest, or that is destroyed, you can say. So creation and destruction is nothing but manifestation and unmanifestation of the effect. And that means effect is always there potentially in the cause. And that goes with the Gita Vakya also. Nasate vidyato bhavaha, na bhavo vidyate sataha. So the non-existent can never come into existence. And the existent, really existent thing can never become non-existent. So this is Gita Vakya, and that is a very basic thing for us to understand. So in keeping with that, our theory of causation is very clear. Both cause and the effect are always there. So all these things are very clearly said in this verse. Tasmai Shri Guru Murtaye Namaidam Shri Dakshinamurtaye is repeated. Okay. So that Guru Murti, okay, who is also Dakshinamurthy, correct? So Dakshinamurthy is only Ishvara who is doing all this projection of this world. We have to understand like that, okay? Like even a Mayavi or a Mahayogi, Dakshinamurthy is projecting, making this entire world appear. And Dakshinamurthy himself is both the Nimitta Karana and Upadana Karana. There is no two different things or anything. There is only one cause. That's how Veda also is presenting Ishvara to us. Okay, Veda is revealing. And I have told you, Veda is the only pramana to understand Ishvara. You cannot arrive at all these things purely by logic. You can give supporting logic. That is fine. We can give analogies. But logic alone, you cannot arrive at. Even see, science also, many things are based on axioms. You cannot ask proof for axiom. You indirectly prove the axiom by creating a theory based on the axiom, and then for that theory, for that hypothesis, you can have experiments designed, and then you can say that the hypothesis is proved. That means the original axiom also must be correct. Like that, you can arrive at. See, even second law of thermodynamics and all is an axiom only in science. Many axioms are there. Even special theory of relativity is based on an axiom that the speed of light is constant for any observer, regardless of the speed at which the observer is moving. Speed of light is constant. Now, there is no proof for this directly or anything. The whole theory is based on this assumption, you can say, or axiom. And since the conclusions of the theory are experimentally proved, we assume that the axiom also is correct. But in a different boundary condition, we don't know whether this axiom will hold good or not. Is that clear? So like that, whatever Veda is revealing, we have to take it as a means of knowledge. And then whatever it is revealing is valid knowledge. Because it can never be disproved, at least, definitely. So, abadi tattvam is there. And whatever it is revealing is anadigatam. It is not available through any other means of knowledge. That is why it is even a means of knowledge. Understand that. If whatever is available through science has to be repeated by the Veda, Veda is useless. I can as well go with science. So we don't require science. Whatever is revealed by Veda is revealed by Veda. It is valid in itself. It doesn't require any validity from science and all that, because many people have this. They think that by saying Veda is scientific and all that, they are validating the Veda, which is actually wrong. In fact, they are invalidating Veda. They are making Veda irrelevant by saying it is scientific and all that. So this point we have to understand. So here, the Vedic vision about creation and cause and effect is revealed by Shankara in this verse. Then we also saw how Sureshvara is giving his Vartika, his explanation here. So we'll look into that now. In fact, first couple of verses I think we already saw last time. We can quickly see that. So he says, Upadanam prapanchasya sayuktah paramanavaha. So first he takes the Vaisheshikas. So Vaisheshikas are the original atomic theorists. Okay. So they say everything is born out of paramanus. Okay. Like even the pot is born out of clay particles. So mridanvitaha ghataha tasmat bhasate na ishwaranvitaha. See, ghata, pot, is because of the particles of clay coming together. There is no Ishwara there for them. Ishwara is not there as a material. Only if pot is created, what is there is only clay particles. Ishwara is not there as material. What we observe is that clay comes together and forms the pot. So the Vaisheshikas and Nayayikas are the original objective people, Darshana. See, they go by whatever you observe. But even they make some claims which are not observable, like paramanus. So they say paramanus are subtle things, you cannot see them. Okay, but they say that you can infer. They have their own inference for that, which is not really a valid inference, but they make this claim that everything is formed out of these paramanus, which are atoms. Paramanus themselves are not available for cognition. In fact, two paramanus come together and form dvanuk. Okay, they call it dvanuk, means two atoms have come together. Then three dvanuks come together and form a trenuk. And afterwards only it is all cognizable. Okay, it comes into cognition. So they have this atomic theory. So according to them, Ishwara is not Upadana Karanam. Okay. Only Paramanus are Upadana Karanam. This is Vaisheshika. Then also, what about all these variegated qualities, this variety in the creation which we see, correct? They say they are all also coming from only the atoms. The Paramanu Gata Eva Gunaha Rupa Rasadayaha. So gunas, there are actually 24 gunas are there according to the Nyaya Vaisheshika Darshana. Later on, in fact, Sureshvara himself will enumerate all that. So I'm not going to enumerate it right now. Like color, taste, etc. Okay. So there are n number of qualities which can be categorized under 24 categories, you can say, or headings. And they are all paramanugata, they are all in the karana, which is paramanu. So according to them, whatever is there in the karana only appears in the karya. So if the karya has to have a quality, it has to be there in the karana. That they say. So that's what is said in the second line here. Karye samana jatiyam arabhante gunantaram. So any guna, okay, you see in the karya, it has to have some connection with in the karana. Okay, karana guna only is appearing. It may appear in a slightly different form in the karya. Okay. But it has to be there in the karana, according to them. Okay. Then they have their own terminology. In fact, if you read our different commentaries, or even Vedanta Shastra, all the terminology is supplied to us by the Nayayika, by the logicians. Okay. So they are the ones who create all the terminology. Of course, the Vedantins also, we create our own specific terminology. We don't always stick to them, but in general, we go along with their terminology also many times. So here, they have their own way of classifying different types of causes. So, karyam yatra samandeti, karanam samavayi tat. So, again, this Nyaya Vaisheshika people, they categorize everything as padarthas. Okay. Padartha means, in general, meaning of a word, you can say, correct? Padasya arthaha. Padartha. So there are seven different categories of padarthas. They categorize everything into seven, or sometimes six also. It depends. Okay. Dravya, guna. Okay. Dravya means substance. Guna means quality. Then there is something called samanya. Samanya means whatever appears in different individuals, okay, and abstract qualities, or even any other, even action, things like this. You can abstract it into a universal, correct? That is what we can even say, jati. Jati, vyakti, we say. Okay, there is a species or a universal, and it is manifest in the individual. So we are a human being, means human beings have, human being is a jati, correct? And a particular person, individual, is a human being. Like this, samanya vishesha also are padarthas. Okay. Samanya is jati. Vishesha means what makes each individual unique or different from each other. There are so many visheshas are there. You cannot count everything, correct? Differences. Samanya vishesha. Then they also talk about something called samavaya. Okay, what is this samavaya? So samavaya in English they translate it as inherence. Okay. Inherence means what? See, there has to be a connection between dravya and guna, let us say. See, there is a quality like redness. You say red pot. Means the red color is there in the pot. Now, what is the connection between this redness and the pot? Means they say it is samavaya sambandha. Or even let us say, what is the connection between pot and clay? Because in a clay pot, what is really there is clay only. Correct? If you touch the pot, you are touching the clay. If you weigh the pot, you are actually weighing the clay. Even when you look at it, actually you are seeing clay only. But still there is a potness. Now what is the connection between this potness and clay? Means they say samavaya sambandha. Between the cause and the effect, there is a samavaya sambandha. Between a dravya and a guna, between a substance and quality also, there is samavaya sambandha. Between a jati and vyakti also, there is samavaya sambandha. So like this, they call it inherent connection, you can say. Okay, there is an inherence, samavaya. In fact, the samavaya itself, Vedantins, we don't accept. But that's a separate discussion. We'll see it some other day. But they talk about samavaya. And the upadana karana in their terminology is called samavayi karana. Why? Because the material cause and the effect are there available in the same place, correct? The material cause only appears as the effect, in fact, according to us. But they say that material cause only becomes the effect and it is available in the same place for cognition. And they both are connected by this samavaya sambandham, according to their theory. So the effect inheres in the material cause. Okay, in English, if we have to say, and that inherence. So whatever is connected by inherence, the whichever karana is connected to the karya by this inherence, is the samavayi karana, which is the material cause. According to us, whatever we call upadana karana, in Nayayika terms, it is called samavayi karana. So karyam yatra samandeti, wherever the effect inheres in whichever substance, that is the samavayi karanam. Okay. And it is not other things like chakradhyam sadhanam yattu ghatasya asamavayi yattu. Then they also talk about asamavayi karanam. Asamavayi means that which is not inhering, the effect does not inhere in that cause, but still those things are required to produce the effect. Like the chakra, in the case of a pot, you require a wheel, right? Potter's wheel is required. You rotate the wheel and then only you can shape the pot, correct? The potter is shaping it. So the wheel is not, wherever you look at the pot, the wheel is not available there, correct? Pot does not inhere in the wheel. Pot inheres only in the clay. But wheel is required. And other, even stick is required to rotate the wheel, let us say. So there are so many other things which are required to create the pot. They are all asamavayi karana. They have an instrumental role to play. Okay. But they are not coming along with the pot. The pot does not inhere in them. So they are all asamavayi, non-inherent causes, you can say in English. Okay. Chakra, etc. So now there is a samavayi karanam, asamavayi karanam. Fine. Then what? Samavayini tishte yat samavayi ashraye tatha karye avadrita samarthyam kalpat kalpyate asamavayi tat. So further he is explaining here. Samavayini tishte. Okay. So samavayini ashraye. So why do we call it samavayi karanam? He is explaining here, Sureshvara, whatever I explained already. See, the effect is inhering in whichever cause, okay? And it is there. Tishte means it is established or it is inherent. Samavayini, that's what. That ashraya also. It is the ashraya. It is the ashraya means what? It is the place where it is, correct? So, in whichever place the effect inheres, that is the samavayi karana. That is why it is called samavayi. Okay. And whichever causes which are still required to produce the effect, but the effect does not inhere in them. Okay. Avadhrita samarthyam means they have the capability to produce the effect. Like even the wheel and stick are all required. Okay. Using them only you can produce the pot means they have a certain capability with which you can actually see that the effect is coming. They are all called asamavayi. Okay. So for the ghata, mrid, the clay is the samavayi karanam because the pot inheres in the clay, you can say. Clay is the ashraya or the locus for the pot. Then you can also say the wheel and the stick and any other instrument if you use, they have the capability to produce the pot, but the pot does not inhere in them, so they are all asamavayi. So the samavayi karanam, asamavayi karanam, these two are explained further in this fourth verse. Then there is still these two alone are not enough, correct? The instruments and the material themselves will not become the pot. You require a potter, an intelligent, conscious being is required. That is what is called nimitta karanam. And here, Nayayikas accept that Ishvara is the nimitta karanam, according to them. Like the kulala, like even the potter. So here, nimittam karanam tesham, Ishvarasya kulalavate. So like even the potter is required, potter who is an intelligent, conscious being, who has the entire design of the pot in his head, okay, in his mind, in his intellect, that intelligent being is required to create the pot. Similarly, Ishvara is the all-knowing Ishvara, and so Ishvara's knowledge is required to produce this entire Jagat, and whatever is further produced in the Jagat also. Ishvara is always a Karana. In fact, Ishvara Iccha, Ishvara Kriya, Ishvara Jnana Manal, they include as a Sadharanam Karana, they say. Okay, they are all, certain things are always counted as a cause in any effect. Even space, time, Papa Punya also, this Adrishta is taken as one of the cause. Okay, like this, they list some nine things are listed by this Nayayika as a Sadharanam Karana also. So Ishvara is taken as a Nimitta Karana. Without Ishvara, nothing. Ishvara's knowledge and presence is required for anything to be produced. Of course, for this entire Srishti as a whole, Ishvara is the Nimitta Karana. The materials are Paramanus, because Paramanus only become the actual Mahabhutas, according to them. And they are only now appearing actually as a material. In the effect, whatever material is there, is formed by the Paramanus only. So they only have to be considered as the material cause. And Paramanus themselves are Nitya, according to the Nayayikas. They are always there. And Ishvara only brings these Paramanus during the creation. Ishvara uses these Paramanus to create the world. During dissolution, these Paramanus and all become separate. See, two Paramanus have to come together to become Dvenu. And three Dvenuks have to come together to form a Trenu. Then only the Srishti comes. But if the Paramanus disintegrate and be as Paramanu only, that is Pralaya, according to the Nayayika. Okay, so they have their own theory like that. So according to them, only Ishvara is only a nimitta to bring all these Paramanus together and then create this variegated world. So nimittam karanam tesham Ishvarastha kulalavate yat karyam jayate yasmat tasmin tat pratitishtati. So whatever karya which is produced, okay, from whom, okay, and then it is all there, okay, it is established, it is there, it is present there. So the kulala is required. Similarly, Ishvara is required, from whom all this, and Ishvara's knowledge is required, correct? So first, any creation presupposes a knowledge, particularly if it is intelligently put together. So for that, we have to accept Ishvara as a nimitta karana. So that's what is said here. So this is their theory. Further, again he is summarizing their argument here. So he says, Mrittikayam ghataskantau pataha swarne anguliyakam. So Mrittikayam ghataha. So the pot is inhering in the clay, the cloth inheres in the yarn, okay, and the anguliyakam means ring in your finger, okay, it inheres in gold, swarne anguliyakam, iti vaisheshikaha prahuhu. So the vaisheshikas say that the material cause is not Ishvara, okay, the different effects inhere in their own materials, and those materials further can be reduced into paramanus, and they are the ultimate material cause. And it is accepted by Nayayikas also. Prahuhu tatha Nayayikaha api. So the Nyaya Vaisheshika we consider as one almost, because the Vaisheshikas only give all these categories and the creation theory and all that. The Nayayik, so the ontological aspects are handled, or the metaphysics is handled by Nayayikas. Sorry, the Vaisheshikas. The Nayayikas are the epistemologists. Epistemologist means what? They are the ones who talk about the theory of knowledge. How knowledge takes place, what are the different means of knowledge, what is error, what are the different theories of error. All these things, the epistemology is from Nayayika, and they both accept each other in those domains. And so Nyaya Vaisheshika we look upon as one normally and study also that way. So this is their theory now. This Nyaya and Vaisheshika people say effects inhere in their material cause, and material causes themselves can be reduced to their paramanus only. There is no Ishvara in that. Ishvara we will accept as a Nimitta Karanam, as an intelligent cause. Because Ishvara's knowledge is required and Ishvara's Kriya is also required. Ishvara only has the knowledge and puts together all these paramanus to create this world. That is their theory. Okay? So this is one theory where again the material cause is different from the intelligent cause. So that way they are actually Veda Viruddha only. Even though the Nayayikas accept Veda as a Pramana, they say they interpret either the Veda differently, or they say only using logic we can establish Ishvara. Like that, their claim is that. But even that we don't accept. We show that their inference is actually faulty. It is not a sound inference. But anyway, they are the original Ishwaravadin at least. So the Nayayikas try to establish Ishvara with only inference, and for them inference is a very important means of knowledge, even more than Shruti. But they accept the Shruti also. But Shruti is very clear. Both the Nimitta and Upadana Karana are only Ishvara, but they don't accept that. Okay, so this is one part of the argument. Then what? Then there are Sankhyas are also there, correct? Sankhya and Yoga Darshana. So when we talk about six Astika Darshana, six our own school of thought and all, they say in English, or a want of better word, but I don't go along with that. Our darshana means it is a vision, you can say better. Okay. So there are different visions about who you are, what is this world, how did this world come about, what is moksha, what is freedom, all these things. There is a different vision, you can say, or a standpoint. So the Nyaya Vaisheshika we saw already. Then Sankhya and Yoga are also there. Sankhya Yoga are also very closely related to each other. We consider them as one. Only difference is Sankhya does not accept an Ishvara. Yoga is a Seshvara Sankhya, we say. Yoga people accept Ishvara. Sankhya Darshana in itself does not accept Ishvara. Ishvara is not required for them. So they also have their own theory. What is that? They say Rajas Sattvam Tamasteti Pradhanasya Gunastrayaha. So they say the material cause, the Upadana Karana for this world is Pradhana. Pradhana is their own terminology. Okay? Pradhanam is, sometimes they also call it Prakriti. Okay? Prakriti Pradhana is the material. And this Prakriti is Trigunatmika, means it has three gunas, three qualities inherent in itself, called Rajas, Sattvam and Tamas. Okay, so there is a Rajo Guna, there is a Sattva Guna, and there is a Tamo Guna. So Rajas is for activity, passion and all that. Sattvam is again for knowledge, enlightenment, brightness. And tamas is again indicating covering something, darkness and ignorance and all that, and laziness. Okay, manda. So like this, there are three qualities. This prakriti or pradhana is the material cause, and which has these three qualities. And these three qualities, in fact, he is explaining in the next line. Rajo raktam chalam teshu sattvam shuklam prakashakam tamah krishnam cha avarakam srishti stityanta hetavaha. So the rajo guna is rakta. Means rakta means you can say red, or also you can say passionate. Because it is chalam, also it indicates activity. Okay. And then, or even when adrenaline is flowing, it's all rajas. Okay. And even your face may become red and all that. Red. Or even in anger. So like this, rajas is associated with redness, passion, activity. Then sattvam is shuklam prakashakam. Shuklam means bright, white. Knowledge, prakashakam also again brightness. Then tamas is krishnam, darkness, and covering, avarakam. And they are the cause for shritti sthiti antahetavaha. So rajas is the cause for shritti, and sattvam is sustenance, and tamas means you go back, because it covers, it is going back into a unmanifest state, correct? So it is avarakam, covering. So it is the antahetu. Anta means here pralaya. So like this, rajas, sattvam and tamas are there in the pradhana, and they are the cause for srishti, sthiti and pralaya also. For the creation, for the sustenance and the resolution. And like this, who says this? Iti sankhyasta bhashante tesham dushana uchyate. So why did this verse started? Why this verse started? Okay. The Nayayikas and Vaisheshikas are saying like this, that the material cause is Paramanu. Ishvara is only Nimitta Karana. Then the Sankhya and Yoga also, Sankhya themselves say only Pradhana alone is the cause. Pradhana itself becomes automatically this world. Then again it goes into pralaya, means some kind of an equilibrium state. See, equilibrium for them is rajas, sattvam and tamas, all of them are in equilibrium, means it goes into a resolution. Or at least you can even say tamas is predominant. Then when rajas becomes predominant, again srishti starts. And then it is all going on. Srishti is there, sustenance means sattva is there. And then again tamas becomes predominant, means it goes back into resolution. This keeps on happening. There is no role for the Purusha. See, Sankhya also accepts Purusha as a conscious being. But Purushas have no role in the Srishti happening. But whenever Srishti happens, due to ignorance, the Purusha gets entangled in the Prakriti or the whatever in the Srishti. And that is the problem. So the Moksha according to Sankhya is what? You separate out the Purusha and the Prakriti and know Purusha only as a conscious being. That's it. And Purusha is Asanga. That is Moksha. But still they are all Dvaitins, because for them both Prakriti and Purusha are equally real. Okay. And the Yoga Darshana people, they come and say there is a special Purusha called Ishvara, who actually disturbs the equilibrium and brings about the creation. Okay. Who uses the Pradhana to create. In this, all other Purushas, they get deluded and they get identified with the Prakriti or the in the creation itself. that is the problem. Again, Chitta Vritti Nirodha and all you have to do. Okay, you stop all the modifications of your mind and bring quiet in the mind, and then discover that you are nothing but only a conscious being, unconnected to anything else, and that is moksha. Okay, so like this, they all have their own theories. And all this is now Dushanaha Uchyate, means what? Dushana Uchyate. These things are now condemned, negated by this verse, whatever Shankara is Bijasyantari Vankuro Jagadidam. That verse is actually condemning these views, the views of the others, which are all faulty, which is not correct. Okay. So that we'll see next time. Okay, we'll continue. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.